Good evening, everyone. My name is Tom Hauser, Chief Political Reporter for 5 Eyewitness News. Welcome to the 2018 Minnesotans Military Appreciation Fund Dinner. I will be your emcee tonight. You may notice we have started right on time. We're so close to the airport. I thought an on-time departure tonight would be a good idea. Now, join me once again with another round of applause for VocalEssence and their terrific version of America the Beautiful. Honest to God, they give me goosebumps every year. Every year. Although Philip has never asked me to join the group. That will become, the reasons for that will become evident as the night goes on. The critically acclaimed professional chorus was formed in 1969, directed by Philip Brunel. We're thrilled to have them performing tonight and next year, their 50th anniversary. Incredible. Philip is only 37, so he'll tell us later who was the original director over there. Now, over the past several years, I have had the privilege of serving as emcee for this annual event, and it honestly is a privilege. It's great to be back to help MMAF support Minnesota veterans and their families. Tonight, we are going to hear from two very powerful speakers who will share their stories of service, sacrifice, and duty to country. A little backstory on my family. I am very proud of my family's military service. My dad served in the Air Force as a doctor for 4 years back in the late 1940s and early 50s. My uncle, Rod McGinnis, my mom's youngest brother, gave his life in service to his country. He used to fly a reconnaissance plane off the USS Coral Sea, and his plane went down in 1963 over the South China Sea. They never found his plane, and they never found my uncle. It was something that my mom had a difficult time dealing with till the day she died, to lose her youngest brother in that way at the tender age of 23. I also had an uncle, Len Guerin, who flew a number of combat missions, I think nearly 100, in Southeast Asia back during the Vietnam War. And sadly, a few years after that war ended, he ended up dying of Agent Orange poisoning from some of the missions he flew where he was dumping the Agent Orange as part of his missions. So clearly, he also gave his life in service to his country. And I am very proud of them to this day. And like the members of my family who have felt the call to serve, many others, in fact, many of you here tonight, have shouldered the burden of protecting our nation and worked to extend the freedoms we enjoy as Americans to other people around the globe. We're here tonight to honor these brave service members and their families. They all deserve recognition, certainly the utmost respect, and a sincere thank you from all of us. Many are still serving and may be deployed again in the very near term. Of course, it takes a community effort to fully support military members, veterans, and their families in this increasingly divisive and complicated world. But by joining together, we can accomplish great things. That's why your decision to be here tonight is so important. And isn't it great to see such a full room tonight? Give yourselves a round of applause. Together, we can say thanks to those who have served and those who are serving and keep this statewide effort strong and vital. We can let our military members and veterans know we are deeply grateful for their many sacrifices. I'd like to welcome our special guests who will share their stories tonight. I'll just ask them each to rise at their table for now and soak in the applause that is so richly deserved. They are retired Air Force Colonel Ken Rizer. Ken Rizer, right here in front. I just learned Ken is a Southwest High School graduate, used to play hockey there, and I'm a big hockey guy, as a lot of people in this room know, and it was fun to make that connection with Ken. Also, please welcome former Army First Lieutenant Trista Matascastillo. Trista? There is Trista. Trista needs to know my only goal tonight to stick the landing is to not screw up the pronunciation of her name. How did I do? Did I do okay? All right. Luckily, she's not an East German judge. She was very gracious with her. I think she gave me a 10 on that. Now, we also want to welcome the family and friends who have come tonight to support these two heroes. Let's have a round of applause for their support systems. And we're going to hear more from them, their insights and experiences, and I'm sure they will inspire all of us tonight and remind us why we should all be so thankful, not just for what they have done, but what all the men and women in the military have done for us. Now, I will ask you to please rise as members of the 934th Airlift Wing Color Guard present our colors, and please then remain standing for a great performance of the Star-Spangled Banner.
Colors. And, right, holder, Holders, ready, cut, forward,
And thank you once again to VocalEssence for that beautiful performance of the Star-Spangled Banner. You may be seated. For our invocation, and to describe the significance of the missing soldier table tonight, please welcome Army Chaplain and Lieutenant Colonel Buddy Winn, a veteran of tours of duty in Iraq, Kuwait, and Korea. Colonel?
Good evening, everyone. Good evening, everyone.
Good evening.
As we think about those who are far away, we remember those who did not make it home, because our fallen must not be forgotten. There are also prisoners of war and those missing in action. I invite you to direct your attention to the front right corner of the room, to our empty table that represents the missing soldier. Now, each item on the table is significant. The single red rose reminds us of families who kept safe waiting for their return. The candle that's lit represents their unconquerable spirit. The slice of lemon on the plate represents their bitter fate. And the glass that's inverted represents the fact that they're not here to toast with us tonight. May we never forget. Will you pray with me? Gracious God, it's by your hand that we enjoy the blessings of abundance and peace in this nation. And it's by your grace that those blessings continue, even though there are some, even us, who often forget to give thanks. Our grateful hearts are quieted by the realization that every good and perfect gift comes from you and that you never change. Let us continue to be grateful for those who serve the cause of freedom in uniform and for their families for their contributions. Lord, may we be continually provided with military and government leaders of character and strong moral foundation who count the cost of sending America's sons and daughters into harm's way. And may we continue to be humbled by communities and well-wishers who acknowledge the sacrifice of service in uniform like those gathered here tonight. Lord, please bless our food, our conversation, and our fellowship to your glory. Amen.
And thank you for that invocation, Chaplain Winn. Now, as we continue with our program, please feel free to begin enjoying your salad and make as much noise as you want banging that fork against a plate. I don't mind. I have four kids. It's just like my dinner table at home every night. Now, I'd also like to tell you about the brown packages that are on each of your tables. These are called tailored operational training meals, known to service members as totems. Totems are similar to the more familiar MREs, meals ready to eat. Totems use commercial packaging to reduce costs. The totem is a totally self-contained packet consisting of a meal packed in a flexible meal bag that is lightweight and fits easily into military field clothing pockets. This is what some members of our military personnel might be having for their dinner tonight. It's a small symbol of the larger sacrifices our military makes for us. I hope you'll pass it around your table and think about what our troops are eating in a faraway land. Now, the next song, this is Goosebumps time, people, if I can have your attention. Folks, if I can have your attention, it's Goosebump time. It is the time for the Armed Forces Medley. And we ask that all members of the military please stand as your branch is recognized in the song that I'm certain you will recognize. Take it away.
Over hill, over dale, we will hit the dusty trail, and the caissons go rolling no more. In and out, hear them shout, hunter march and right about, and the caissons go rolling no more. And it's high, high heat in the field artillery. Shout out your numbers on and strong. From the halls of Montezuma to the shores of Tripoli, we will fight our country's battles in the air, on land and sea. First to fight for right and freedom, and to keep our honor clean, we are proud to claim the title. ready for the call. We place our trust in thee, through servants or
applause for VocalEssence. That never fails to give me goosebumps. Now, folks, if I can keep your attention just for a moment, we've got some very important announcements to make here and an introduction. I would like to introduce Roger Sitt, who is the MMAF chairman and CEO of Sitt Investment Associates. Roger continues his father Gene Sitt's vision for MMAF. Prior to his career in finance, Roger was a captain in the U.S. Air Force, serving 6 years active duty with financial management responsibilities at Headquarters Space Division. Roger graduated with military distinction from the U.S. Air Force Academy in 1984. Somehow they have left off his bio that he and I were Little League teammates somewhere around 40 years ago in the city of Edina, and he was one hell of an infielder. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Roger Sitt.
Okay, what Tom failed to tell you was an infielder being in the dugout. Thank you, everyone. I'm glad to see everyone here tonight. Tonight, we honor military members for their commitment and sacrifices. We honor their families for their unending support and encouragement. And we thank all of them for their importance to our nation and the sacrifices they have made for us. Tonight, we also extend our gratitude to everyone who has donated in the past, as well as those donating this evening to MMAF. I want to just also note that more than 90 cents of every dollar that is raised goes directly to our service members. Our mission is pretty simple and straightforward. It's simply to award cash grants and a way of saying thank you to our Minnesota service members that have served honorably in a hostile territory since 9/11. There is no conditions on how the grant is spent. Some use it for hospital bills, some use it for travel, some use it for tuition. But we just want to award these grants as a way of saying thank you. I am pleased to report that thanks to your generous contributions, MMAF has given away grants totaling more than $10.9 million to Minnesota service members. And tonight, we will award our 17,000th grant. Our grant breakout is as follows. $500 grants have been awarded to 16,440 Minnesota service members who have served honorably in a combat zone without injury. $2,000 grants have been awarded to 495 Purple Heart recipients, and 215 of those 495 have received a second grant totaling up to $8,000 based on the severity of their injuries. And finally, $5,000 grants have been awarded to 65 families who their service member was unfortunately killed in action. These grants are a small relative to the commitment and sacrifice our service members and their families are making, but again, it's just a form of saying thank you. And what they do for our country is faithfully serve without politics. They are prepared to do whatever our country calls upon them to do, no matter who is in office or what party that person represents. We celebrate their honor and commitment to our country. Okay, much has changed since the tragedies of September 11, 2001, and those first deployments of service members into Afghanistan and Iraq. While the media no longer covers the day-to-day operations of our deployed troops, combat operations are far from over and large deployments are still occurring. The Pentagon reports that more than 255,000 service members are stationed abroad in more than 170 countries. In Syria, Iraq, and Afghanistan, primarily where our deepest involvement in fighting is occurring, we have more than 25,000 service members currently there. Since 9/11, more than 45,000 Minnesotans, have served in a combat zone, many more than once. This includes the National Guard, reserves, and regular active duty. Currently, more than 160 soldiers from Minnesota 851st Vertical Engineering Company deployed to Kuwait last week in support of operations in Iraq, Syria, and Afghanistan. And later this year, it's expected that 700 to 800 Minnesota National Guard soldiers will be deployed. There are more Minnesotans on active duty and reserves that we just don't have the data on that are also serving in these hostile territories. Therefore, the bottom line is our mission is not complete. We support our Minnesota military members and their families. We owe a great debt to those who carry the burden for the rest of us in the country. We must uphold and honor the selfless men and women. So thank you very much. At this time, I would like to award MMAF's 17,000th grant. The grant will be awarded to Gunnery Sergeant Kyle Holland. Can you please come to the stage? Before I award the grant, let me just say a few words on Gunnery Sergeant Holland. Marine Corps career began in 2005 after he enlisted as an intelligence operator and analyst, which included unique training with Morse code. During his 9 years of active service, he served in 9 commands, including 3 deployments with the 31st Marine Expeditionary Unit and Operations Enduring Freedom in the Philippines and Afghanistan. During a deployment in the Philippines in 2005, his unit provided intelligence for a team of Army Rangers and Green Berets whose mission was to combat local terrorist training camps. This was done while living in bamboo huts in the dense jungle. In 2012, while deployed in Afghanistan, his unit was again tasked to provide intel to the Army Special Forces. Gunnery Sergeant Holland also had an opportunity to serve as a combat marksmanship instructor, and he trained more than 5,000 Marines and soldiers on their marksmanship skills. Since departing active duty in 2014, Gunnery Sergeant Holland has been serving in the Joint Intelligence Reserve Unit as a senior enlisted leader, providing time-sensitive support to unit commanders. On behalf of the Minnesotans Military Appreciation Fund and the people of Minnesota, I am proud to award Gunnery Sergeant Kyle Holland with our $500 check as a token of appreciation for his service and sacrifices.
Thank you. Wow, 17,000. What an accomplishment. You know, during my time on active duty, I had the opportunity to either visit or live in 25 states and 9 countries. Quite the experience as a young Marine. But when my time ended in 2014, I decided there was no question where I was coming home to. Back to Minnesota. I take great pride in being a Minnesotan, but not just because of the delicious goulash or world-class fishing that we have here, but because Minnesota Nice is a genuine persona and Minnesotans truly care about each other. The MMAF and all of you here tonight are a testament to your devotion to service members past, present, and future. What an incredible honor it is. Thank you for allowing me to share it with you tonight. Thank you.
Before I relinquish the stage here, I'd like everyone to raise their glasses for a toast not only to Kyle, but all our Minnesotans who have served. Here's a toast to Kyle and Minnesotans military and their families. Again, thank you for coming tonight, and please thank you for the continued support, and please enjoy the evening.
Big round of applause for Roger Sitt and the Sitt family. And a special round of applause in honor of the late Gene Sitt, who started this all and was a great man. And I'm sure he is smiling down tonight as he sees Sergeant Hamlin get that award. And I got to tell you, when the Marine Corps song came up, he was the first Marine out of his seat. And you could see the pride on his face. And I didn't even know he was the one who was coming up here to get that special award, but I noticed him right away. So congratulations to you, Sergeant Halland. All right, well, time now for dinner. We're going to take about 20 minutes for dinner, and then we'll be back to resume our program, and we'll wrap up here around 9 o'clock or so tonight for an on-time departure. So enjoy your meal. We'll see you in a few minutes. We got the reason you all came here for coming up right now, other than, of course, VocalEssence, which is outstanding. Let's have another round of applause for VocalEssence. I would now like to introduce one of our honored guests, retired Air Force Colonel Ken Rizer. Colonel Rizer attended the United States Air Force Academy and served 25 years as an Air Force fighter pilot and commander, including time leading men and women in combat tours in Iraq. Colonel Rizer commanded Andrews Air Force Base, home of Air Force One, from 2010 to 2012. At Andrews, he was responsible for multiple air wings, 60,000 military personnel and their families, and security for all senior U.S. and foreign officials. In other words, if you read between the lines, he had a lot of spare time in his hands at Andrews Air Force Base. I also just want to tell you one really quick small world story. So I'm sitting with dinner with Colonel Rizer over here. And over here is his family, and it turns out that his aunt is married to Bob Coates, who is a relative of my wife's. So in some roundabout way, Ken and I think, are like brothers. I haven't done all the, we haven't worked up the DNA and all that, but we both like hockey. So we're pretty sure, at least when it comes to hockey and caring for the military, I think we're brothers. Without any further ado, ladies and gentlemen, retired Lieutenant Colonel Ken Rizer.
Thank you for that nice introduction, Tom. And where are we doing Christmas this year? I'd like to thank the MMAF for inviting me to speak tonight. And I'd like to thank all of you for coming here tonight to support our military members. Why don't you give yourselves a big round of applause? As Tom said, I was the commander of Andrews Air Force Base. And one of my responsibilities as the commander there was to greet President Obama whenever he flew in on Marine One or Air Force One, or any time he played golf at Andrews Air Force Base, which was just about every nice weekend. That wasn't a slam on President Obama, honestly, it wasn't. I think it was a great way for him to deal with some of the stress of the presidency. So President Obama and I have probably 100 one-minute, one-and-a-half-minute conversations. And I'm here to tell you that President Obama is an absolute gentleman, and he treated my airmen and me with the utmost of respect at all times. But there was one time when the commander-in-chief and I did not see eye to eye. And I felt an obligation as a military member to tell the commander-in-chief what I really thought. And so I said, as we were walking from Marine One to Air Force One, "Mr. President, Brett Favre and my Minnesota Vikings are going to kick your Bears' asses tonight on Monday Night Football." Well, you know, the president, being a diehard Bears fan, responded, "Well, a picture paints a thousand words." And unfortunately for Brett Favre, our Vikings, and myself, the president was right that time, but since then, the Bears have been the victims of the Vikings on more occasions than not, and I look forward to this season when that will happen yet again. I want to thank all of you for coming here tonight. It means a lot that you come here on a Thursday night when you could be doing all sorts of other things to support our Minnesota military members. What I would like to do tonight is just share with you some personal stories that for me encapsulate what it means to support our military and what our military does for us. I'd like to start with my grandfather, Dr. Dean Rizer. He lived in Minnetonka, Minnesota. And Grandpa was a military doctor during World War II. He was part of the Greatest Generation, and during the Battle of the Bulge, which was the bloodiest battle for the United States in World War II, Grandpa flew into France on one of those troop gliders, crash-landed, and he ended up commanding an army field hospital during the Battle of the Bulge. And he told me a story of how there was a soldier, who came in and was in pretty bad shape. And my grandpa ended up saving this major's life. And as the major was recovering, he said to my grandpa, "You know, I really want to give you something." And he had nothing really to give. So what he did is he took off his gold oak leaves off of his uniform, and that's what this picture is in front of you. And he gave his gold oak leaves to my grandpa. Well, when I graduated from the Air Force Academy and became a second lieutenant, Grandpa presented those oak leaves to me. And when he did so, he said, "Ken, you are starting to carry the torch of a proud legacy of military service. And I want you to take these oak leaves because I want you to remember the service and sacrifice that has gone before, so that you can carry that torch with honor." You know, the Greatest Generation lost more than 400,000 people in World War II. And their service and sacrifice was so great that they provided freedom and liberty to Western Europe, huge parts of Asia, and other parts of the world. In my first operational assignment, I flew reconnaissance F-4s in Korea. And the F-4, for anybody who knows about it, was proof that with enough thrust, even a rock can fly. So I used to go mountain biking on the weekends in the hills and mountains around Daegu Air Base in Korea. And there was one day I decided I was going to ride my mountain bike up the highest mountain in the area. So I started up this street. It was a paved street, two lanes, and then it became one lane, and then it got narrower and narrower, and it became a cart path. And I got about three quarters up the way up the mountain, and this cart path came out into this clearing, and there was actually a rice paddy there, and there was this farm up this mountain. It was a little family farm, as far as I could tell. And as I pulled my bike in there, there was this little tiny woman who was probably all of about 4'9", and she was hunched over a little bit. She looked a lot like this woman. She'd been working in the fields her entire life. And she came up to me like a lightning bolt, right at me, this tiny little woman. I've never been so scared by a tiny little woman before. And as she came up, I said, "Annyeonghaseyo," and I bowed to say hello, and she said, "Annyeonghaseyo." She came right up in my face. Well, actually, her face is down here, but she's looking up in my eyes, and she put out her hands like this, and I realized she wanted me to put my hands out. So I put my hands out, and she grabbed my hands, and she looked in my eyes, and she said, "America, America, America." And then she let go of my hands, and she backed up, and she started bowing. And I didn't really understand what was going on there, and I bowed back, and I said, "Kamsahamnida," which is thank you, and I got back on my mountain bike and started going down the hill, and I was trying to figure out what was this all about. And as I rode the bike down the hill, I got it. This was a woman who had been a young woman during the Korean War. And that was a war that killed 2.7 million civilians. So imagine what she and her family and friends had gone through. And the North had pushed so far south that they were about ready to push our forces and our allied forces into the sea at Pusan. And then the American military intervened and did an amphibious landing at Incheon. And at the end of that war, ended up establishing an armistice. And in the decades that followed, under U.S. support, South Korea went from a third generation, third world kind of country to a first world country. And I don't know if you've been to Korea recently, but I mean, it's phenomenal when you see their airports and their buildings and how clean their cities are. They're the 11th biggest economy in the world. And so I think what that woman was doing was I think she was thanking me as a representative of America for all those sailors, soldiers, airmen, and Marines who fought for her country and gave her kids and grandkids and great-grandkids the same kind of opportunities that American kids have here. More than 50,000 American military service members lost their lives in Korea, and South Korea is free now as a result. I flew combat missions in Desert Storm in 1991. And after coming back from the war, I was stationed in Texas. And Texas does nothing small. So they did the biggest military parade and festival celebration that you could ever imagine. And my kudos go out to the Marines and the soldiers in the room, because I'll tell you, the Marines and soldiers, they were marching in absolute perfect step, looking really, really sharp. I didn't see any sailors, but I can tell you, we Air Force guys were on flatbed trucks sitting on hay bales waving. We're not stupid. So we're sitting on these hay bales, and we're in our desert tan flight suits, feeling like heroes coming home from the big war, waving to everybody. And as I'm looking out in the crowd, I see a gentleman that looks a lot like this gentleman, kind of behind the crowd. And it is obvious to me as I look at him that he is a Vietnam vet, because he has his medals and he's got his pins and he looks to be about that age and he looks a little bedraggled like this guy. And as I catch his eye, he snaps to attention and he whips out one of the sharpest military salutes I have ever seen. Well, I immediately, you know, get off my duff and the hay bale. I stand at attention and I return his salute. And then he slowly dropped his salute. He nodded, and then he turned around and he walked away. And I had to think, what was that all about? And as I thought about it, I thought, you know, when he came back from his war, there were no parades. When he came back, he and his fellow service members were spat upon. They were treated horribly. They were held responsible for political decisions that they had nothing to do with. And I think when he was saluting me, what he was really doing is, first off, he was giving me the welcome home that he never got. And I think, secondly, maybe in a way, he was basking in this celebration of American military service in a way that somehow reflected upon him. 58,000 American servicemen died in the Vietnam War. This is Captain Ben Slingerzettel. Slinger was tops at everything he ever did, whether that was graduating from the academy, graduating at the top of his pilot training class, getting his first choice of an F-16. When he came to my unit in Clovis, New Mexico, he was the best wingman in his class. He had 300 hours, and he was already getting ready to upgrade to be a flight lead. He was the next guy in the flight lead upgrade. He was married to a beautiful, smart, and vivacious young woman named Molly, and they had their entire future ahead of them, and the future looked very bright. On September 9th, 2002, I was leading a three-ship of F-16s on a night ride. We were doing red air, which is adversary air. We're pretending we're MiGs, fighting against four of our fellow F-16 guys who were going to fly past us, you know, try to shoot us down, get to a target, drop simulated bombs, and then try to fly back through us. Slinger was my number three that night. It was very, very dark. There was no horizon. And this was before everybody was checked out on night vision goggles. So none of us were wearing night vision goggles. The first engagement went very well. And we saw the strikers go into the target, saw them come back out, and then we started down track to provide that second look for the blue air. Slinger got to a point where he was supposed to do a level 180-degree turn away from the blue air, and then he was supposed to descend 10,000 feet. And about the time he was going to do that, I was going to turn 90 degrees to the blue air, roll upside down, go down 10,000 feet, and then when I come out, I was going to pitch back in to try to shoot the blue air down. So I did my maneuver. I'm coming out of it, and as I come out of it, there is a massive explosion in the desert that looks like a nuclear bomb going off. I immediately call a knock it off. I say, knock it off, fireball, knock it off. Fireball 1, knock it off. That was me. I hear Fireball 2, knock it off. I don't hear anything from Fireball 3, who's Slinger. And then I hear the other flight, and they all check in. And then I say, Fireball 3, check. And I hear nothing. And it turns out there was no beacon, which meant he hadn't ejected. And what had happened was Slinger, instead of doing a level turn and then descending, had done a slicing turn, had become disoriented, and had gone into what aviators call a death spiral, where you think you're level, but you're really not. You're really in a tight turn going downhill, and as he's accelerating up through about 600 knots, he recognized what was happening, and he rolled out, pulled his power back to idle, speed brakes out, and he pulled as hard as he could. And if he had had 200 more feet, he would have made it. You know, he was my charge, he was my responsibility, and that night I didn't bring him back. I led the missing man formation at the Air Force Academy. Tears rolling down my eyes down my face as I flew over his gravesite. You may not know this, but more military members die in training accidents, car accidents, and from suicides than ever die in combat. Which gets us to Arlington. So when I was base commander at Andrews, all of the airmen at Arlington National Cemetery were in my command. So I had all the chaplains, I had all the honor guardsmen. By the way, kudos to the honor guard tonight, Air Force Honor Guard, you guys did a great job. And I had all the bandsmen. So I spent a lot of time at Arlington. And we did about 1,000 funerals a year. And we did those funerals no matter what the weather, no matter what the conditions. And it was awesome to watch these airmen because every single movement from the way they carried the casket to the playing of taps to the firing party, you name it, it was all done with absolute precision and excellence because when you're doing a military funeral at Arlington, there are no do-overs. For that family of that airman, there's only one funeral that matters, and that's the one you're doing right then. So I went out to Arlington one day, as I often did. On this particular day, it was really miserable. It was kind of like a Minnesota winter. I mean, it was cold, it was sleeting, the wind was blowing, the sleet was going sideways. It was gray. It was miserable. And I went up to Master Sergeant Smith, who was going to be the detail commander for the next funeral coming up. And I said, Master Sergeant Smith, how are you doing on this blustery day? And he said, sir, I have never been better. It is a great Air Force Day. And I kind of did a double take, and I said, Master Sergeant Smith, the weather is horrible. It's freezing out here. What are you talking about? It's a great Air Force Day. And he said, sir, you know, when we do funerals on beautiful days at Arlington, the sun is out, there's a light breeze, all the families and friends come out, and he says, it's wonderful. But he said, you know, when the weather's really, really bad, like today, the only people that come out are the immediate family and us. And he said, you know, sir, that is when I really feel that I'm doing what I'm supposed to be doing here. And I'll tell you, when Master Sergeant Smith said that to me, I felt a little ashamed. You know, anybody who's been in the service knows that NCOs and senior NCOs are always educating their officers. And on this particular case, he shamed the colonel a little bit, who was whining about the weather, because Master Sergeant Smith got it. It was all about honoring those airmen, honoring their service and what they had done for their country and honoring their families. That's what we're doing here tonight, isn't it? You are all like Master Sergeant Smith. You could be other places. You have other things to do. this is a great event, but maybe you could have more fun someplace else. But you are here tonight because you want to honor those sailors, soldiers, airmen, and Marines, and Coast Guardsmen who have served, are serving, or will be serving. So you're just like Master Sergeant Smith. You know better than most that freedom isn't free, and that whether you're from the greatest generation serving on a battlefield in France, or if you're at the Chosin Reservoir in Korea, or if you're on some hot LZ in Vietnam, or you're fighting the war on terror, or the countless other things that are going on right now that we don't even know about. In all of those cases, we have people who are putting themselves in harm's way so that we might be free. So I thank you on behalf of everyone who's ever worn the sacred cloth of our nation. I thank you for your support. And I hope tonight you will continue to be as generous as you've been with your time and your money, because what MMAF does in this state, in this great state of Minnesota, is remarkable. And I don't know of any other state that has a similar kind of program. So thank you again, and have a great night.
Wow, that really brings it home why we're here. Some heart-wrenching stories, to be certain. Although I really paid attention when he said that he and President Obama had about 130-second conversations, reminded me of me and my wife. We've only been married 25 years. Come on, it might not be 100, but we've had some 30-second conversations, trust me. We've got 4 kids. We're going in a lot of different directions. And again, thank you Colonel Rizer. That was just outstanding. And we have another outstanding honored guest tonight. I would like to introduce former Army First Lieutenant Trista. God, Trista, we had even practiced this. Matascastillo. See, I nail it every time, but I had to look at it again and study it. She currently works for the Minnesota Assistance Council for Veterans. She began her military career in 1992 when she enlisted in the United States Navy. As an avionic technician, she became the first female to serve in that command. She was selected into a commissioning program and transferred into the United States Marine Corps. After 4 years with the Marine Corps, First Lieutenant Matascastillo transferred to the Minnesota National Guard, where she served as a full-time officer. Matascastillo became the first female air defense officer and the first female commander of the 34th Military Police Company. One of her most challenging roles, however, was serving as a watch officer, and watch officers are tasked with the grim task of notifying families that a loved one has been injured or killed. And I do always remember my mom telling me the story about when somebody from the military came to her door to tell her about her youngest brother, and I know that is something that was important to her and stuck with her until the day she died. So the work that Trista did is very important, and she's going to tell us more about it right now. Please welcome former Army First Lieutenant Trista Matascastillo.
3 for 3.
7 times, so I had to keep saying it.
Awesome. Welcome. Thank you. Good evening. It's such an honor to be here with all of you tonight and be in the presence of such incredibly generous people that have supported the Military Appreciation Fund and service members like myself and my family. It truly reminds us that we have not been forgotten and that our service is recognized, and so thank you again. So I served in the military for 16 years. Having served in the Navy, the Marine Corps, and the Army National Guard, often as the only woman in my command and all that goes with that. As if that weren't enough, I also married an Army Ranger who served in 13 combat tours. Unfortunately, my husband Hector is not able to be here tonight because he's actually keynoting his own event in Iowa tonight, training all of the Iowa's law enforcement on trauma and mental health. He continues to serve, as do I. But he does send his best to all of you here, and thank you for your ongoing support. I've been asked to share my personal story and experience, having served 16 years in 3 different branches. You can imagine it's been quite a journey. I started my career as an avionics technician in the Navy at just the age of 17. And I arrived as the first woman in my command shortly after Tailhook broke out in a F-18 squadron out in the middle of the California desert. And when you're a young enlisted person, in addition to your daily job, you also have the privilege of standing watch. Often on the flight line, where in the summer months it's excruciatingly hot, and in the winter months it's miserably cold. It wasn't exactly a job I wanted to do, so I discovered if I volunteered to be on the honor guard, I wouldn't have to stand watch. Pretty smart. So the honor guard performed ceremonies like retirement ceremonies, ceremonies like tonight, and it was a great alternative to standing on the flight line. It was the early 90s. We weren't at war, even though we trained as though we were. And occasionally, we would then also be assigned to do funeral details. We probably did 1 or 2 a week. We never really knew any details about the veteran or who they were. Rarely, we would learn their name or what service they were in. They were usually World War II veterans. It seemed very distant from who we were. As part of the duties, you would do the ritual 21-gun salute, fold and present a flag to the next of kin. It's pretty straightforward. As I served on the honor guard, I moved up and became the squad leader, which meant that it would be my turn to present the flag to the next of kin. I was an 18-year-old E-4 petty officer at the time. Well, my first funeral came, and it happened to be a graveside funeral. So I was standing there next to the family during the entire service. And in that service, each family member stood up and told a story, a personal story about their father, their husband, the grandfather. And as I stood there, I listened, perhaps too closely to be able to be objective. But I listened to that story and I got to know him in just that brief time of his funeral. And so when the time came for me to present the flag, I stood before the widow, I took down one knee, and I reached out with the flag in my hands, and I had this well-rehearsed speech, you know the one, on behalf of a grateful nation. But when I handed her the flag, I got about 3 words out of my mouth. I said, on behalf of, oh, and I began to sob. And the more I tried to control myself, the more I sobbed. And I completely lost control. And this widow, grieving, she stood me up, she wrapped her arms around me, and she held me. And she comforted me, an 18-year-old, telling her how grateful I was. It was a moment that I realized I never again wanted to be standing in front of a family member and tell them how grateful I was and to be in that presence of grief. From that point on, I stayed with the rifle squad, safely in the distance, away from the family, and never getting too close. Fast forward about 10 years. I had completed my time in the Navy, served a tour with the Marine Corps, and was now in the National Guard. It was 2003, and we were at war. I was the first and only woman in the Minnesota Army National Guard, first of the 216th Air Defense Artillery Unit. I had been the Distinguished Honor Grad in Officer Candidate School and my Officer Basic course. So I got the privilege and honor to be the platoon leader for the Scout Platoon, an unheard of recognition, especially for a woman. I was assigned a platoon sergeant who was an Army Ranger who had just reenlisted after 9/11.
And we knew that sooner or later, we would too get the call to go overseas. So we trained hard. He knew that every one of our 43 men needed the training that would save their lives, because it would be a matter of life and death. We became a family. I knew every one of them personally. I knew their wives, I knew their families, I knew their quirks. I knew when the platoon sergeant was being too hard on them, and I knew when they were ready. My platoon sergeant, Sergeant Matt, as we called him, and I had a love-hate relationship, as most lieutenants do with their platoon sergeants. He was always intense. And because he took his job very seriously, he had seen combat and he knew what it could do. A guy like that doesn't have many friends. His intensity was hard to endure. But we became friends, and we knew when the orders came that we would lead our men to war together. In 2006, during the peak of the war, those orders finally came, and we were ready. Only when we received the orders, our unit was to reclassify for the needs of the Army. They would deploy as an infantry company. And at that time, women weren't allowed to serve in the infantry. What that meant for me was that my platoon would be broken up, they would deploy without me, and I would be the designated stay back. Some people think that's a blessing, but any leader knows that when they train, that they want to go. They want to be with their men. They want to be together as a unit that they've trained for. Because I couldn't go, I was transferred to a full-time position in the Joint Operations Center as a watch officer. It's a place kind of like a 911 call center. So when you hear of things in national emergencies or emergencies in the state of Minnesota and someone says, hey, why don't you call the National Guard? We answered the phone. So it's also a place that when there are emergencies, flood duty, fire duty in northern Minnesota, that we answer the phone. But what we also did is we tracked every soldier and airman from Minnesota in and out of deployment. Well, my first day on the job, I walked into the jock, and a message had come back. And when we saw the casualty report, I recognized the names. It was three of my platoon members. I remember holding my breath and thinking that I knew this day would come and I would be ready for it. But you're never really ready for it. All three of them, I thought, I know them. I know their families. I know their loved ones. And then I remembered what my boss, Colonel Wickman, now General Wickman, said. Remember, first reports are always wrong. Just take a deep breath. So I left the jock and I went into the latrine, and as I was throwing water on my face to regain my composure, a young PFC bounced into the latrine, and she was so excited to see a familiar face. Only she was the wife of one of those men. And I thought to myself, I can't say anything to her. She doesn't know what I know. So we exchanged chit-chat. She told me about their new baby and how excited she was to hear from her husband in a few days, knowing he had been out on a mission. I took a deep breath, and I drove back on. Luckily, it was good advice. The first report was bad. They were injured, but all of them survived. It hardens you. It becomes almost routine. But at the same time, you remember the details. You remember their names. I remember all of the 247 names that came across the watch while I served. Some were injuries, and some were fatalities. We got good at our jobs. We improved the process. The process was notifications to family members. Injuries received a phone call. Killed in action would be delivered in person. Nothing happened before DNA confirmation. We sent the message bearers out in pairs, often with a chaplain, followed by a casualty assistance officer who would then stay with the family throughout the process. We started a practice of debriefing our notification officers. We tried never to send them more than once because we knew how hard it was on an individual. And I remember one day a sergeant first class saying to me after he had completed his notification, "Ma'am, I don't know how you do it. I've been to war. I've put my buddies in body bags, but I'd rather go back to war before I ever do another notification." One of the last calls I received while serving in the JOC was a call from a young commander who was forward deployed. He was clearly in a panic. It was hard to make out what he was saying, and the delay on the line made it even more difficult. I knew who he was, because he was the commander who had picked up my platoon sergeant and promoted him to first sergeant. His report: "My first sergeant was on a convoy. It's been blown up. I think he's dead." My heart stopped beating. My mind went mechanical. "Captain, do you have DNA confirmation? Do you have boots on the ground with witnesses? Remember, first responses, first reports are always wrong," I yelled at him in the phone. "Call us back when you have confirmation," and I hung up on him. I was visibly shaken. And just at that moment, I felt my cell phone vibrating in my pocket. As I looked down at the caller ID, I saw the name, Laura Castillo. It was my platoon sergeant, his first sergeant's mother. Her timing was impeccable. I stepped outside the JOC and answered sheepishly. In her strong Spanish accent, she apologized for bothering me, but she just couldn't shake a feeling she had in her gut. She knew that something truly bad must have happened to her son. She knew that he had been out on a mission because he had told her the last time he was spoken, but she hadn't heard from him in days, and she couldn't shake the feeling. I took a deep breath, grateful that she couldn't see me, and I prayed that she wouldn't hear the quiver in my voice. I assured her that he was fine. I was confident that we would hear from him soon, and everything would be okay. It was 3 days before we heard from him. They had been hit by an IED, and they had to limp their vehicles back without communications. They were rattled, mild traumatic brain injuries, but everyone was alive. I think that was the moment I knew I needed a new job, and that I probably had the worst job in the military. Luckily for me, that first sergeant was thinking about the same thing. After the longest deployment in Red Bull history, our guys returned home, and I was there to greet them. Sergeant Matascastillo and his mother joined me at the welcome home ceremony. She was as excited as I was to see them. I was grateful at that moment that I never told her what had happened. I'm not sure she would have survived it. A few weeks later, he surprised me and he proposed. I didn't see it coming. I resigned my commission and accepted his proposal, but not before I confessed to his mother that I had already lied to her once. I promised her I wouldn't do that again. I resigned my commission. I never went to war. But I had experienced enough of it to know that I had truly fulfilled my service and duties to my country. We're both civilians now. We've got a combined family of 5 sons, and we can continue to serve our veterans every day. He's the nation's leading mental health therapist on trauma and working for veterans and men coming out of incarceration. And I am working hard to end veteran homelessness. I still jump when the phone rings, but now it's because I have teenagers. Thank you so much for being here, for hearing our stories, for giving from the heart, and continuing to recognize and honor our military veterans. It really matters. Thank you.
That was terrific, Trista. And if I could ask Ken to come back up here, and Trista, please stay up here. I'd like to thank both of you for outstanding comments and insight and sharing with us your experiences. It was unbelievable. As a small token of our appreciation for your service, as well as your support to MMAF, I'd like to award you each a desk trophy. And Trista, to you as well, thank you very much for your service as well as for your thoughts.
One more round of applause for these wonderful heroes. Ken Rizer and Trista Matascastillo. How am I doing? You know, people always ask me, you know, what'd you major in to be on TV? I said, well, it was kind of a unique major, reading out loud in class. That's all. It's really all I have to do. I have one job, is to pronounce her name right. Trista, you know, I was thinking when you were going to come up here, I thought what a tough act Ken was to follow. And what it's like the New York Yankees. It was the number three hitter and the cleanup hitter came up here. The heart of the lineup, I think, was up here. And I think both of you really drove home why all of us are here tonight. So thank you again, Trista and Ken, for your service to your country. Our evening is just about done. Again, we're heading to that. We're going to pull away from the gate, maybe even a little bit early, because we've gone ahead of schedule a little bit. I would like to invite you all to the MMAF Summer Event, Say Thanks Day, on August 25th, where you can run a 5K or walk a mile to say thanks to our veterans. You can learn more about Say Thanks Day from the Save the Date postcard that was placed on your chair. You should find it at your table. Or you can learn more on the website thankmntroops.org, thankminnesotatroops.org. If you wish to support MMAF, consider making a donation tonight in the name of someone you know who has served. You may do so as you exit in the donation box at a table outside the ballroom. It's important to note that SIT Investment Associates has underwritten this entire event tonight to ensure that every dollar raised here tonight, every dollar goes back to our military and their families. Let's have another round of applause for SIT Investment. By being here tonight, you have helped thank Minnesota troops to the tune of nearly $500,000. Now give yourselves a hand. I know there's a lot of familiar faces in here. And as you leave, please feel free to take home the beautiful flower centerpiece at your table. You can wrestle amongst yourselves for who gets to take it. There is no hidden thing under your chair. You literally have to wrestle for it. That's how this works. It's very military-like. Now, if you wouldn't mind to conclude the evening, please stand as our color guard retires the colors and remain standing for our final song from VocalEssence, God Bless America. Have a great night, everyone. Please drive safely. And that concludes our program.